Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel Food Tech Talks. In today's video, we would discuss a new topic from the course of Food Safety Officer exam, which is food irradiation. Guys, today we are going to cover the following topics: introduction to irradiation of food and their principle, and ionizing and non-ionizing radiations, and characteristic of alpha, beta and gamma rays, and the levels of gamma radiation such as radiopterization, radicidation and radurization, and lastly some selected MCQs. This is presented by me. If you have any doubts and suggestion, you can drop your comment below this video, or you can contact me through this mail, foodtechtalk123@gmail.com. Let's get begin. What is food irradiation? Food irradiation is a process of exposing food to an ionizing radiation to destroy and check the growth of microorganisms, bacteria, virus or insects that might be present in the food. Further application include sprout inhibition, delay of ripening and improvement of rehydration. Gamma and beta radiations are generally used in food irradiation. Principle of food irradiation is that the ionizing radiation can penetrate food materials to varying degrees depending on the food and the characteristic of the radiation. And they have also the ability to knock out electrons out of the atoms of the material through which they pass. In brief, the irradiation process involves exposing food to a specified dose of ionizing radiation inside a biologically shielded irradiation chamber. When the ionizing radiations of moderate energy level pass through the food, there were a collision between ionizing radiations and food at molecular and atomic levels. Thus, a heat were created, and this will break the chemical bonds between the atoms and cause destruction of DNA of microorganisms. So, let us understand the difference between ionizing and non-ionizing radiations. Ionizing radiations are short wavelength with high intensity radiations. Examples are gamma rays, X-rays or electron beams. While the non-ionizing radiations has longer wavelength, so that they can't penetrate the substance, so that they can only used for the sterilizing surface. Example, UV lights used in the purification of water. Let's move on to the next slide. Let us see the difference between alpha, beta and gamma rays. Alpha rays are the helium atoms minus two outer electrons. They can't even penetrate a sheet of paper. While beta rays are high electrons, which may referred as cathode ray. They are more penetrative than alpha rays, but can be stopped by a sheet of aluminium. Move on to the gamma rays. They are photons. They are highly penetrating and can penetrate a block of lead if it is not too thick. And the sources of gamma rays are cobalt 60 or cesium 137. Now, let us see the unit of radiation. Unit of radiation is gray, which is denoted by GY. It can be defined as 1 gray dose of radiation is equal to 1 joule of energy absorbed per kg of food material. In radiation processing of food, the doses are generally measured in kilogray. Moving to the next slide, we have the classification of gamma rays. In radurization, the dose level would be varies from 0.75 to 2.5 kilogray, which will target specific spoilage microorganisms. Move on to the radicidation, it have the dose of 2.5 to 10 kilogray, which will reduce of non-spore forming pathogens. And finally, radiopterization, which has the dose of above 10 kilogray, which is used for commercial sterilization. Moving to the next slide, we have the classification of gamma rays based on their dose applications. They are classified as low dose application up to 1 kilogray and medium dose application from 1 kilogray to 10 kilogray and high dose application is above 10 kilogray. Let's start with low dose application. Sprout inhibition in bulbs and tubers up to the dose of 0.03 to 0.15 kilogray. Delay in fruit ripening up to the dose of 0.25 to 0.75 kilogray. Insect disinfestation including quarantine treatment and elimination of foodborne parasite up to the dose of 0.07 to 1 kilogray. Moving to the medium dose application, reduction of spoilage microbes to prolong shelf life of meat, poultry and seafood under refrigeration at the dose of 1.5 to 3 kilogray. Reduction of pathogenic microbes in fresh and frozen meat, poultry and seafood up to the dose of 3 to 7 kilogray. Reducing the number of microorganisms in spices to improve hygienic quality up to the dose of 10 kilogray. Moving to the high dose application, which is above 10 kilogray. Sterilization of packaged meat, poultry and their product which are shelf stable without refrigeration up to the dose of 25 to 70 kilogray. Sterilization of hospital diets up to the range of 25 to 70 kilogray. And product improvement as increased juice yield or improved rehydration. So guys, let us end up this video by solving some MCQs related to food irradiation. Here the first question we have, irradiation otherwise known as. Here the options are sterilization, hot processing, cold pasteurization and none of the above. Here option C would be the right answer, cold pasteurization, because in irradiation there is no or little heat were produced. Moving on to the second question, sterilization by irradiation referred as dash. Here the options are radiolization, radicidation, radapterization, none of the above. As we discussed earlier, sterilization by irradiation referred as radapterization. Here the option C would be the right answer. Now moving on to the third question, which of the following not used as a radiation source? Here the options are cobalt 60, electron radiation, cesium-137, neutron radiation. As we discussed earlier, cobalt 16 and cesium-137 would be the source of gamma radiation, which are most commonly used in food irradiation. And also electron radiations can be used as a food irradiation. So here the option D would be the right answer, neutron irradiation, because neutrons have high penetrating power than the above mentioned. So it would make food radioactive, so that neutrons are not generally used as a radiation source. Moving on to the fourth question, UV light has germicidal effect at dash wavelength. Here the options are 200 to 230 nanometer, 230 to 245 nanometer, 250 to 280 nanometer, none of the above. Here the option C would be the right answer, that is 250 to 280 nanometer. So guys, this is the end of this video. I hope you find this video helpful for the upcoming FSO exam. If you haven't subscribed the channel Food Tech Talk, you can subscribe now and also press the bell icon for the regular updation. Thank you for watching.